Hi, I'm Kelly Kimry with the Alamance County Health Department. I have a little boy, and recently I've been concerned about the H1N1 virus. I've invited Dr. Kathleen Chapley Quinn, Medical Director of the Alamance County Health Department, to answer some of these concerns. What is H1N1, and why are so many people worried about this flu versus the traditional flu we see each year?
H1N1 is a flu virus, and it causes an influenza-like illness, not surprisingly. The other thing that's important to know about this is that a couple months ago, people were calling this a swine flu. We've switched the name, but it's the same thing that we're talking about. And in terms of why people are worried about it, it's because it's a new virus, meaning that humans have not seen this virus, or their bodies, their immune systems haven't seen this virus. And so scientists have wondered, how will we react to this virus? We've been fortunate to have a couple months of experience now and to know that in the United States that this virus in general is causing a mild to moderate illness. It's not severe at this point. We're not exactly sure what's going to happen over the next few months, though.
So what are some of the symptoms of H1N1?
The symptoms are the same as with seasonal influenza. Temperature usually greater than 100 degrees, sore throat, cough, achy muscles, fatigue feeling, and with kids sometimes there's vomiting and diarrhea, or even with adults.
And something that's different about this flu is the age group of the people that we've seen in North Carolina especially. What's the age group that it typically affects?
You're right, 53% of the people who've been affected in North Carolina are less than 24 years of age, and that's not typical for seasonal influenza.
Okay. So how severe is H1N1?
H1N1 hasn't been severe for most people in the United States. There are some people who seem to be more severely affected, and those are the people who we're pretty careful about when we hear that they have the illness, and those are people particularly with chronic illnesses like diabetes or heart disease or lung disease.
Okay. And how does the virus spread?
The virus spreads also, we believe, the same as with seasonal influenza, through coughing and sneezing. And what happens is when someone coughs or sneezes, then there's little particles that are formed in the air, or what we call droplets, and those can be transmitted to another person when the other person breathes in those droplets. The other thing about those droplets is they can land on a tabletop or a desk or doorknobs, and what happens after that is other people who touch those surfaces then often just in the normal course of a day would touch their face, their mouth area, or their nasal area, and the virus can be transmitted in that way as well.
So how is this virus treated?
And the virus is treated, I think about it, in two kind of separate ways. One way is the common sense things that we do whenever somebody gets sick. We try and make sure, maybe most importantly, that they stay very well hydrated so that they don't end up in the hospital with dehydration. And comfort measures like taking Tylenol or ibuprofen, resting, those kind of things. I think it's important to make a brief mention that for children under the age of 18, we really discourage use of any aspirin products or aspirin itself. Those can cause some complications that we really just want to avoid. There are antiviral medications, and there's definitely some people who would really benefit from those antiviral medications. Because of their increased risk of having problems. So those would include children less than 5, pregnant women, and all of those people, children and adults with chronic illness.
Is there a vaccine for this virus, or will one be available soon?
There's not a vaccine at this point. The federal government and the vaccine manufacturers are really working hard to put a vaccine together that'll be effective. We don't know exactly how long that'll take. I think the manufacturers are hoping that they will have one ready in the fall, but we just don't know quite yet. I'll mention one other thing about the vaccine, and that is that we expect that if an H1N1 vaccine is made available, that it'll be a series of 2 vaccines. And then the seasonal vaccine for influenza, which is the vaccine we normally offer and encourage people to get in the fall, is a separate vaccine. So people need to be thinking that they might need 3 influenza vaccines this fall in order to protect them for the flu season.
So what should somebody do if they have the symptoms of H1N1 right now?
If people have the symptoms of H1N1 and they have any of those high-risk kind of they're in any of those high-risk categories, like they have chronic illness, they have a child who's less than 5 with those symptoms or pregnant, they should definitely call their doctor and talk about whether they need medication. And on top of that, we recommend that people stay home for 7 days. If their illness is prolonged beyond 7 days, then we recommend that they stay home for 24 hours after the illness is resolved. And that's primarily to protect other people from getting the illness.
And of course, washing hands.
And
do hand sanitizers work?
Hand sanitizers do work. Those alcohol-based sanitizers work for this influenza, which is great. They don't work for some other germs that we worry about being transmitted, but for influenza, they do work.
So if somebody has all the symptoms of H1N1, will they get tested for this virus?
The answer to that question is usually not. The benefit of having a couple months of experience with this virus now is that we know if people have those symptoms that I've talked about before, fever, cough, sore throat, unless the physician believes that there's some other reason for that set of symptoms, then most likely they have H1N1 and it won't help to get tested. There's two exceptions to that, and that those include people who are hospitalized. In general, if you're pretty sick with flu-like symptoms and you're hospitalized, then you do need the test. And the other time we really think about testing is when people are in group situations, for instance, children in daycare or camp situations, when they could potentially infect a lot of other people, and particularly if that group of people is high risk, then we really think about testing them. So the physicians in the community in Alamance County call us at the health department and we kind of talk over situations together and make a decision about that.
So will H1N1 continue to spread? Will we see a larger amount of people getting sick in the fall?
We could. Again, we don't know a lot but about this particular virus and the way it's going to act in the community. But we have some experience with pandemic influenza. In past and global situations, what's happened is that the influenza virus often becomes much less visible in the summer. Many fewer people are affected, and then often it comes back in the fall, and it can affect quite a lot of people, and that's what we're preparing for.
Is there anything we should do besides what can we do right now to help prevent the spread of H1N1?
So the things that we can do are largely the things that we've talked about already. Try and stay away from other people who are sick. Cover your mouth and nose if you're coughing or sneezing. Throw a tissue away right after that. Wash your hands. Of course, all of those common sense things are the things that really make a difference.
Okay, is there anything else we can do to help prevent this virus from spreading?
What I like to think about in terms of preparation more than prevention is just thinking about what families can do to be ready and what other communities, what other groups in the community can do. So I really encourage people to think about what they would do if they had a family member who was sick, if they had a child or a parent or a grandparent who was ill. I think that making a plan for who's going to prepare food, how are the kids going to get taken back and forth to their daycare if the regular person who does the transportation is sick, all of those things are really important for people to do in order to feel good about what might happen. I also think that once people have a sense about their own family plan, the next thing is to think about other groups that they might participate in, either at a business place or at a church, at daycare or wherever else, and see if those organizations that they're a part of are prepared. And the really good thing is there's been a lot of people who are really smart who thought about this for a long time, and there are plans that are written out. There's a website that's particularly good. It's www.pandemicflu.gov. And for each of those different organizations, they have a checklist of things that people can go through and just make sure that they've thought about those things and have a plan. And I think that that helps all of us feel better about what's coming up.
Thanks so much for your time, Dr. Kathleen. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Kelly, so much.